hope you're there. I don't know about you, but I reckon this is the low point of the year. Cold and windy, wet and dark. It would be so easy just to stay indoors and huddle in front of the fire. In the early days of ancient Rome, that's exactly what they used to do. They just gave up. For them, the year used to start in March. There were only 10 months. They didn't actually have January and February. At the end of December, they stopped counting. They just called it winter. They stayed home. They didn't come out again until spring began and it warmed up enough for them to creep out and pick up life again where they'd left off. The rest of the world didn't do that, though. You can see what we used to do in this country. Have you ever visited Stonehenge? As the days got shorter and shorter and the nights ever longer, people would turn up here and wait for the shortest day on about the 21st of December. People still do. When the sun lined up the right way between the stones, they knew everything was all right. It was going to be okay. Life would go on. They could all go home and get ready for the new year. It gave them hope. They were probably afraid every year that the miracle might not happen. This time it might go on getting darker and darker, and the whole thing might just pack up. Even nowadays, a lot of people do actually get a bit gloomy at this time of year as December goes on. That's why we put up Christmas lights and have parties, have special food, give each other presents just to cheer each other up. It's probably why Christmas got put at this time of year, indeed, to begin with. No one knows exactly what month Jesus was born. So let's have a big party at the end of December. Give us all something to look forward to. Actually, you can already tell in nature that the year is ready to turn. There are trees that only flower at this time of year. I took this picture in London last week. I don't know whether we've got one around here like this, but it's a cherry tree, and already there were insects flying around collecting pollen and nectar. In a few days' time, we'll begin to see the snowdrops poking up through the bare earth. And it's not just showy things like flowers. Look at this plant in my garden. It looks like a bunch of dead sticks. It's going to have to be cut back for new growth. But already, look at this. Already, look at this. There are buds getting ready to start the new growth. The spring gets born out of winter. Spring gets born from out of winter. But it's not spring yet. We mustn't get ahead of ourselves. As my mother used to say, you mustn't wish your life away. We're still in Advent, and I've got to try and remember what I'm meant to be talking to you about. So let's start this properly. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. A tiny light. A tiny prayer for all God's blessings everywhere. Bread my finger then. Hope, love, joy, peace. There are the four big themes of Advent. And today we come to the last one, peace. And it's an important one for Christmas. Remember the shepherds on the hillside above Bethlehem, how they heard a choir of angels sing, "Glory to God in the highest, and peace to his people on earth." It wasn't a time of peace then. The Romans were in charge. They were busy building their empire. The place was full of Roman soldiers. And yet the angels sang of peace. Do you think the world is a peaceful place at the moment? I'm not going to try and make you miserable by really asking you that question. The truth is, there's never as much peace as you could hope for in the world. And I spoke about this enough on Remembrance Day. I don't need to go into it any further now. But we look around the world and we do see places where there's violence, where people don't feel safe, where men, women, and children are mistreated, where there's hunger, war, people being made unhappy. Some of those things perhaps aren't so very far away from us. And all these people we're thinking of, they could be our friends. If we could sit down and talk with them, we'd find out how much we have in common. We'd know that they mean us no harm and we wish no harm towards them. But there are places in the world where nice, kind people are sitting down just like us, this morning and saying, "Those poor people in England, they really do need a bit of help from us. They're in chaos over there. If only they could be a bit more like us. If only we could step in some way and change things for them." Well, they think they might not like it at first, but they'd end up a lot happier. Well, I don't know how you feel, but most of us quite like things the way they are. We may not be too keen on people coming in from outside and trying to change things here. No, I'm not going to say a lot about this because it's not going to happen, partly, but there are really only two things to say. Yes, we do want peace, and we do need peace in the world, and we're going to do what it takes to make sure that it stays that way. But there are two particular things we're going to have to be sure of if we're going to do our bit to make that happen. First, I said that I'm sure people in the world are generally friendly. But we actually need to be able to talk with them. We can't always insist that they must speak to us in English. There are so many languages in the world that we could learn to speak: Chinese, Arabic, and Russian. As well as French, German, and Spanish, nearer to home. You'll have the opportunity to learn languages, and it's important to remember that you don't just do this to pass exams, you don't do it because you enjoy learning languages, you do it because by doing that you're able to keep the world a friendlier place by keeping proper communication channels open with people. You can talk to them, and that is so important. That's the first message about peace I really wanted to get over this morning. The second is this: as you get to know other people more widely in the world, you'll discover there are people with different values from the ones we ourselves rate so highly here. It's surprising how different other people's values, even the values of whole countries, whole continents, can be from ours. But even if their values seem very different from our own, we do need to try to respect the way they live. If you think they'd be happier if they were more like you, it's not your job to tell them that. The important thing is not to tell other people what your values are, but to live in a way that shows how good and blameless a life well lived can be. Don't make a fuss about how good you are, how well your values work out in the world. Don't tell people if only they got a grip on things and started to practice friendship, forgiveness, compassion, trust, thankfulness, peace, fellowship, and community. Those things are so valuable to us. Don't try telling people who don't share those values that they really ought to, that if only they lived lives like that, how much better everything would be for them. That's not the way you do it. You just go on living the kind of life you know is right. You don't have to be ashamed of. You know that it's the way you choose to live and the way we do. You can only hope in that case that they'll want to model themselves on you. Unless, of course, you look at them and realize it might be the other way around. That might just be true. You need to keep your mind open. As I said, there's so much more I could say, but I can sum it up this way. Glory to God. That's what the angels sang at that first Christmas. Glory to God in the highest, and peace to his people on earth. The world is tired, especially during this pandemic. The world is tired. We're all tired. We're looking forward to the future, getting brighter and getting brighter quite soon. And that will be to do with peace and prosperity spreading through the earth. Here are some words you may hear being read at Christmas. You've heard them already from Isaiah in the Bible. Here they are again. For unto us a child is born, unto us a son is given, and the government shall be upon his shoulder, and his name shall be called Wonderful, Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. Of the increase of peace there shall be no end upon his throne, the throne of King David, and upon his kingdom, to order it and to establish it with judgment and with justice from henceforth, even for ever and ever. That was written 700 years before Jesus was born. You notice it said upon the throne of David, and as I said to you last week, David was a king 1,000 years before Jesus. But in David, it was a golden age, it was a time of peace, and people were looking forward to when Christ would come in and bring peace to the world. So let's finish with a prayer. Father, your son Jesus was born at Christmas. A child was born for us so he could be the Prince of Peace in our good world. Give us your gift of peace this Advent, along with hope, joy, and love, so that through us your world may become a better place, and all around us may be happier and ready to go forward into a new and better year. We ask this in the name of your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen. So let's say together the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done in earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen. Thank you for listening. Thank you for your company. I hope the rest of your day, the rest of your week, be peaceful and will go well.